Hello everyone, welcome to Code and Learn. In this video, we are going to look at Go team's package called Singleflight. So we will begin with a small introduction of Singleflight. When programming a service, you often encounter a case where multiple requests are made simultaneously to fetch a resource from a resource server. If this is your service, in response to multiple client requests, you would probably make further requests to a resource server, which can be a database, for example, or a third-party server from which you're fetching data. For example, think of a service which fetches weather data from another backend server or a database. So assume this is our weather database. So what if multiple requests come in to fetch weather data for same city? Let us take an example of city Ottawa in Canada. So what if multiple clients are requesting the weather data for Ottawa? Then our service would have to make multiple requests to fetch the Ottawa city weather data in response to these requests. So if you think of it, our service is unnecessarily making these calls to the resource server to fetch data because all of these calls are duplicates. So instead of making multiple calls, what we can do is make a single call to fetch the data and then send the same data back. This is exactly what the Singleflight package by Go team does. So using the Singleflight package, you can implement the Singleflight pattern. With Singleflight, you can ensure that your service only makes a single request to the resource server in response to multiple duplicate requests. And once the data is fetched, it shares the data with all requests. The Singleflight package ensures this by putting the duplicate request on hold if the same request is already in process or in flight, which is why it is called Singleflight, because you only have one request for every duplicate request. When the current or the in-flight request returns the response, the data is then shared between the request and we send back the response. So that's the gist of it. Let us now look at some code. First, let me initialize a package. Go mod init. So let us now look at the Singleflight package. As you can see, it has a type called group and then three methods on group. The first one is do, which takes a key string and a function to execute, returning interface, which is the result, error, and a shared bool, which is an indicator if the request data was shared between multiple requests. Similar to this, we have doChan, which accepts a keystring function, but instead of returning the result, it uses a channel to return the results. Then we have forget. In case you want Singleflight to not use results from the in-flight call, we can then forget the key. So here we have the group struct. Group represents a class of work and forms a namespace in which unit of work can be executed with duplicate suppression. Once you create a group, you call do. You provide a key, which would be the key that is used to see if there's any duplicate requests. So if key is same for multiple requests, then Singleflight will know that it is a duplicate request. And if there's already a request in place, it won't send a new request, but instead, we'll put the request on hold until the in-flight request returns the data, and then the data is shared between the on-hold requests. And then we have the forget method, that is simply to forget about the key. Future calls to do for this key will call the function rather than waiting for the earlier call to complete. Now let us look at the code of do. Here we have the source code. The Singleflight package uses a map with key values and function calls to keep track of if there's any request with the same key already in progress. So first thing we do is acquire a lock on the map, check if map is nil, we create a new map. Then we see if there's a key present already, we unlock it and then wait for the already existing request to complete. If there's not, we create a new request. So that's the basic gist of Singleflight. Now let us go back to our code and write an example. First function I'm going to write is a get function that will fetch data from a website. For now, we will just fetch data from Google. This function is returning an interface and error because that is what the closure inside do is expected to return. So we are just conforming to it. Inside it, we will just do http.get and then https://google.com. So that's it. Now let's wrap this function with Singleflight. So we can do get data Singleflight. Here we will accept a Singleflight group. So I can say Singleflight group returning an error if there's any. We need to install the Singleflight package. For that, I will just run go mod tidy. That's it. So inside of function, here's the group that we accept. That is the group that will be used to group request. Now let's call the do method on the single flight group. It returns three return values. So I can do g.do, a string, or a key for our request, get Google, and then just pass in the get data function. So as you can see, it returns the result as the actual result error or a shared Boolean key, which indicates if the data was shared between duplicate requests. If error not is equal to nil, we just return the error. Then since we are getting the result in our interface, we need to typecast it to the result we want, which is response. So I can do http.response. And then let us just print the response, fmt printf. Along with the response, I will also print if the data was shared. Here we will do res.status code, and then if shared. Since shared is a bool, I need to provide v, and then return nil. So that's the basic function. Now let's call this function in a Go routine so that we can simulate duplicate requests. Let me start a loop for I is equal to 0, I less than 10, I plus plus. Go get data with single flight. We need to provide a group. For that, let us create one. Var g single flight dot group. Provide the group or the pointer to the group, and that's it. Just to make sure that all the Go routines are completed, let's use a wait group. So var wd sync dot wait group. In here, we will accept a wait group, and in here, let's provide the wait group. Then let us wait on the wait group. Save it, and now let's run the program. Go run main.go. Nothing happens. Oh, that is because we forgot to add number of coroutines we are starting to the wait group. Once we do that, we should see the results. Go run main.go. And as you can see, we are getting the results back. You can see the data was shared between duplicate calls. Now to get more information, let's see how many times the actual function that we adapt with single flight, that is getData, was called. To do that, I will initialize a variable. We will call it count, which is of type int, then a lock because we need to increase that count in the coroutines. Sync.mutex. We can do this and initialize our count to 0. In here, we will do lock.lock count plus plus and then release the lock. So that's the count. Now let us print the count. Fmt println or printf. Original function was called times. And we say count. Clear the console. Go run main.go. And as you can see, the original function was only called one time. Now let me add some delay between the calls so that the original in-flight returns results before we start another Go routines. So I can say if I is equal to 4, I want to sleep for 1 second, or maybe a little less, 100 milliseconds. That's it. Clear the console, run again, only one time. So let's increase it to something like 1000 and see if that makes it. And as you can see, this time our function getData was called 2 times because half of the Go routines were called after the initial call or the first in-flight request returned. That is why the next time it was called, it was considered a new in-flight request, and then duplicates were put on hold, returning the data. So that is basically how you can use single flight to make sure that your service is not making multiple duplicate requests. Now, a question you may ask is, why not use a cache? It is because they both provide a solution for a different problem. Single flight is useful in cases cache template, for example, where your cache doesn't have any data or cache is not hot and your service is just starting. What if you get 1000 requests in that case? Then you would be forwarding those 1000 requests to cache. But if you add single flight in your code, you will only be forwarding one request, and once the cache is hot, you can retrieve those results normally. So software development is all about trade-offs. For example, when implementing single flight pattern, you need to track the CPU usage and memory usage to make sure that single flight is not having a deteriorating effect on your service. There are other edge cases that you need to take care of when implementing a single flight pattern. For example, what if the first request that is in flight gets blocked for too long? All the waiting requests, that is these ones, will also wait on it and will get stuck. In such cases, using a timeout context or a select statement with a timeout can be a better option. Another scenario is, what if the first request, that is this one that we have in flight, returns an error or panics? That same error or panic will be propagated to all the goroutines waiting for the response. To minimize this, one solution is sharding the key to distribute the request. There is a package that does this, and I will paste a link to that in the video description. If you want to do it on your own, what we can do is, if you're getting 1,000 requests or 1,000 duplicated requests, you can distribute them in small batches that can then be used with Singleflight. So I can shard the key to say, first 10 will be badged into 1, then the next 10, and so on. So we will be sharding these 1,000 requests into batches of 10 requests, which can then be collectively used with Singleflight. Depending on the implementation, you can create a custom key for the do method. It can be a combination of function name that you are calling and time rounded to millisecond or microsecond, so that incoming requests that are these are sharded based on that or based on the time they arrive. So first 10 requests that arrived on some date time and 1 millisecond will be sharded to this. 2 millisecond, we have the next batch. 3 millisecond, we have the next batch, and so on. That is something that you can use to shard the request. Another thing to keep in mind is, cache in production environments are shared cache or distributed cache. That is, multiple instances of your service could be using the same cache. This compared to Singleflight is different because Singleflight deduplication is limited to one instance of that service. If we are using Singleflight here, it won't have any effect on this service instance. So that's some comparison between Singleflight and a cache. That's it for this lesson. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please post a comment under the video or reach out to our Discord server. Until next time, happy coding.